People have called it the modern freak show. They've compared it to the morbid curiosity of passing a car around. And others say it's an affirmation that we're not as fucked up as the people on our screens. Regardless of the reason, reality television has captivated the country. Its effects are embedded in our culture. And so far, it's showing no sign of stopping.
Malaysian fishing village, these 16 Americans are beginning the adventure of a lifetime.
I cannot wait to get to the Jersey Shore.
This summer, everyone goes to the shore.
Getting a Jersey Shore house is wild.
That's when they have volunteered to be marooned for 39 days on mysterious Borneo.
That's when the shirts come off and the bikinis come out, and that's where you want
to
be.
A share house is 6 to 10 people.
It's crazy. You have strangers living with you the whole summer.
This is their story. This is Survivor.
Weirdos everywhere, hot girls, and house music.
I want to get into the house, I want to meet some girls, I want to meet some guys, I want to see what's going on. I'm ready to go.
You are witnessing 16 Americans begin an adventure that will forever change their lives. They've been
They're not performers or artists. So the beauty of the success of a show like that is you want to always feel like these people are regular. You always want to feel like you're a viewer who's kind of getting a behind the scenes look into a regular person's life.
You would leave the cameras rolling for an extended amount of time, and you're kind of marrying the notion of documentary filmmaking to television producing.
All of them, I think, want to maintain that connection to documentary itself so that they feel authentic and that they feel consequential.
We are constantly questing for a real space. Like, we want our TV to be real.
It's supposed to be a documentary. It's supposed to be you're a fly on the wall witnessing stuff happening.
You have these strangers living in a house and you have to really shoot them 24/7. They pretty much just have cameras all over the house, like bathroom, bedrooms, living rooms, and stuff like that.
Situation comedies, if you notice, are always filmed upon a stagnant set. And basically the room, unlike your living room or bedroom, had three walls instead of four because the fourth wall was not constructed because that's where the camera was and it was out of shot.
With a sitcom, the idea is the fourth wall is there, but it's never acknowledged. And reality TV is slightly different. The fourth wall is there, but it is frequently acknowledged.
I think it's really important to maintaining the sense that what we're watching is happening organically and that it would be happening regardless of whether or not we'd be watching.
And it could be an incredibly accurate representation of reality. You know, like, I'm sure this video that you have is a very accurate representation of our conversation. But regardless, the way you've chosen to film it, where you've chosen to film it, the light you've chosen, the questions you're feeding me, like how I choose to respond, all of this is, you know, and how you're going to
So that fourth wall is extremely powerful in protecting us from the reality that actually exists and the reality of what it takes to produce that show.
Well, on a show like Survivor, they do use the helicopter a lot to get some of the, you know, amazing shots that they get on the show.
At Challenges, there are maybe 75 people standing around behind the scenes, from camera operators to producers, dream team. But what it also manages to do is conceal the production.
Logo, logo, first to shore. Shapiro right on their tail.
You would think the audience would be totally comfortable with seeing the camera there because you're selling them on the concept that it's reality television. Yet, they don't accept it.
Television wants you to forget the reality that something is being observed.
And when you break the fourth wall for a second, you might let the viewer in on the fact that, oh no, this isn't real.
It goes back to the conventions of the media.
But that's all stuff that's for the viewer anyway.
If you look at the first survivors, they truly wanted you to believe that they were these people stranded on a desert island, and we were supposed to watch how they coped with the trials and tribulations of being on a deserted island.
Without food, electricity, or comforts of any kind.
I'm not eating no rats till I get hungry.
They'll compete for $1 million.
When we first watched the first couple seasons of the show, we're like, oh my God, what do they do? How do they do this? What do they live out there and there's no food? And we really cared more about their relationships because they were some of the first reality stars.
That's not what Survivor is today. Survivor is today contestants performing as inhabitants of a desert island, competing for a game show.
Billions of people have been on reality TV since then. It's not necessarily so interesting, the fact that these people are on a reality show. You know, it's like the Coliseum. Entertain us.
To the point that you start really carving out villains, and you start really carving out antagonists and protagonists, and the viewer is totally on board for it. And not only is the viewer on board for it, the people who are cast for the show are on board for it. So it becomes a culture in and of itself.
So it doesn't really matter, in a sense, you know, who they're bringing back or not bringing back. The important thing is that they're bringing back the essence of that character.
So what you see evolving is the character on the Survivor, the contestant on the Survivor, has his own character arc.
An artificial, formulated character, one created both by show, by the individual on the show, by the culture at large.
And what networks like to do is hone their own talent and not have their talent leave the network and go to another network.
Jersey Show made me famous, but now it's time for me to show the world what I'm all about.
And now a CBS special presentation. Rob and Amber fell in love on Survivor and ran the amazing race. Now they're tying the knot. Rob and Amber get married.
You have an opportunity to multi-purpose a talent. The person can be used as a real person, and we can see the humanism of that person unfold and grow. But that same talent can then be used as an archetype, and you can just use that as your simple, basic villain or protagonist character.
Over 300 people have tested themselves in the most difficult and groundbreaking show on television. We have gathered 20 of them to play one more time. Your favorite heroes versus 10 of the most notorious villains.
Heroes versus Villains was spectacular. And I think that when you bring back people who played Survivor before, that the gameplay is elevated way ahead of where it would be with people who are playing for the first time. And I think that's why returning players have done so well.
And I think when that arises, and when certain stars have fans, it becomes more economically beneficial to bring those back.
I think in the beginning we thought reality TV was going to work because of the reality of the scenarios and the situations that we saw people in, and we just want to acknowledge and view how they deal with those scenarios. We ran out of scenarios.
The biggest draw is the characters. Like, the only reason why our show is successful is because of the people who cast on the show.
So then it's like, okay, well, if we're out of storyline, then the only thing that we can really bank on having an infinite number of variations is character.
Well, that's one thing also I think that kind of shifted over the years is, especially now that they seem more open to bringing people back all the time, is back then they would kind of give people a complete, you know, balanced story.
Yeah.
But nowadays they're kind of like, okay, well, you know, Russell, he's a big character, Coach is a huge character.
And I nicknamed myself the Dragon Slayer. I got voted off. I kind of felt like a fool.
So I came back on Heroes and Villains, and I felt like I became the dragon.
Because let's not, you know, give them all the layers just yet. We can bring them back in a year or two and kind of expand on them then, but let's just kind of build them up as this huge character, and now then we'll tell the story later over the course of a couple seasons.
Do you learn anything about how people perceive you on this game?
I think, you know, the first time I came into it, I came in as coach, where you can never be wrong. You've always got to, you know, keep a stiff upper lip. And I saw myself on television, and I said, that guy's an arrogant ass.
Because people are so diverse and so just incredibly complex that we can always just pick one version of you, showcase that, and then next season we can pick the other version.
Did you get the redemption? You saw it?
Absolutely. You know, we've talked about this. The first show, I looked at myself and I was like, man, that guy is so arrogant. And I didn't want to be that person. And it really, you know, the game has really changed my life without question.
Well, I think the difference here between 5 years or the first 5 years of the show and what it is now, they would get annoyed if you talked about the previous shows because they said, hey, we can't use this. So if on Survivor the Amazon, if we were talking about something that happened on Survivor Africa, it really had no chance of making it into the show because it wasn't about what was happening in that current season.
But Mark Burnett said something like that, you know, the contestants can sit around and talk about production all day, but it'll never make it on the show.
The producers had to constantly tell the players, stop talking about the first season. Stop mentioning BB, stop mentioning Rudy, stop mentioning the alphabet strategy, because this is all they were talking about the first couple days. They just talk about, hey, I'm going to be the next Rudy, or I'm going to be the next Colleen, and the producers had to keep telling them, shut up, you know, it's not going to make the episode.
How big a factor do you think prior relationships, people that have played together before, that others might look at?
They've played on seasons before together, and I don't really have anyone that I...
You watched Jenna and Jerry and you saw how they played last night. They don't play the way you play. You saw me in Africa. I played the same way the entire game.
People are expecting me to be that guy they saw in Token Chains, you know, that guy who's stuck by his word and done it.
So I'll vote out Russell's been here.
Little Rob, as I call him, he's smart.
He's too smart. That's why we need to get him out of here.
I gotta tell you, I'm a little in awe of Rob. You know, he's played it twice. He's intuitive and ingenious and very smart. I'm romancing on my idol. What can I say?
Modern day Survivor, sometimes it's relevant to what's going on, and you're acknowledging like this common wealth of knowledge. That everybody knows.
Everything goes through with this. I have a feeling the next time I see you, there's going to be a big finger wagging in my face.
I think that evolution should be embraced, not inhibited.
They're what we would consider breaking the fourth wall, except they're not talking, they're not actively doing it. It's still concealed within that world.
If the subjects know the camera is there, and the audience knows the camera there, but the audience isn't supposed to know, I know that you know, and I know that you know I know. It doesn't work.
And I think we've seen a little bit of leeway in that recently, definitely with Cochran talking about watching the show that he's actually on and giving the time in that work is something
back
that
we've home,
never quite
I'm waiting
seen
the whole week long for Wednesday night at 8 to arrive so I can turn on CBS and see what's in store. But when you're playing this game, every single day is like Wednesday night at 8. It's wild, and that's what I love.
We want to see the stakes raised. We want to see, you know, something new that we haven't seen before every season. And Survivor does a pretty good job keeping it fresh after 25 seasons that we've seen so far.
And I feel like as a producer, if you aren't real about it and you don't just embrace it and try to make it a part of your storyline in the show, you're just kind of setting yourself up for failure.
MTV is taking you inside a Shore house like you've never seen.
I feel MTV earned with Jersey Shore. If they allowed and accepted that these individuals became characters in their own right, then I think the audience would have accepted it.
Jersey Shore is definitely a much different show than Survivor.
So with Jersey Shore, the premise was, let's find this Italian-American kid who liked to party and drink and blah, blah, blah.
But you're manipulating them by putting them in scenarios and circumstances that a lot of TV producers refer to as a boiling pot.
So they basically invited me, and I'm going to go. I'm going to Miami.
The bitch of Staten Island is back and ready
fucking party.
And that will give you great drama and great entertainment for television.
Hold on, Angelina.
I'm right here, a fucking mosquito in my fucking ear.
You're here because you want to jump on the same bag.
So annoying.
If it would have failed. If it would have failed.
They each have one of those classic roles that you see, whether it's a sitcom, a motion picture, a trilogy.
They create a template for almost anyone to fit into. As long as they perform, in a sense, those attributes, you know, and fit into the discourse that we create around those stereotypes.
And the only way to do that is gym, tanning, laundry.
And you have someone like Snooki, who's a wild child. You have someone like JWoww, who's kind of like, I may party and do all this stuff, but I'm kind of level-headed, and I'm like a mother degree. You have Mike, who likes to party and drink, but also is extremely confrontational and likes to start shit.
I have no problem being the villain. I will take on the whole house at once.
Say hello to the bad guy.
In one sense, they're very replaceable because they're stereotypes, you know?
Snooki is infamous. I miss pickles.
What is it? It's called a Snooki. It's very famous.
They are a character. They are a hyperbole. You know, they are an extension of this phenomenon that we recognize in society. Those are the norms and stereotypes that we have in culture before reality television, but that we can then identify on screen.
I mean, it also speaks to even the way that things are being cast now.
I brought a new friend named Tina. She's 4 feet tall, short little meatball, exactly like Snooki.
You can't get real characters anymore. Anyone who's cast is gonna act like the character they've seen in another show.
I think there's another phenomenon that takes place, and we call it intermediality.
We have no sense of where entertainment stops and starts. TV is no longer a given set of hours in the evening. Reality TV stars' lives are not 30 minutes twice a week. They're constant, and even what we can't see in the space of the show, we see in the peripheral material.
And that sound means summer has officially started on the Jersey Shore, featuring bar fights, drunken arrests, naked picture leaks!
Jersey Shore is filmed before a live studio audience.
A lot of times you would see, like, in the background, like, things, like, roped off, and you'd see just, like, a mob of people, like, trying to follow them.
I remember reading a story about people going into the shop where the cast members worked. Basically, there's a line outside, you have to sign a waiver, and you're basically being cast to walk in and browse around and pretend like you're just walking in organically.
You never want to make it seem like you're following celebrities.
Which by, you know, season 3, season 4, they're not by any extension of the imagination of ordinary people.
It's an uncharted territory to acknowledge your entire cast as being celebrities based on the fact that they are stars of your show. No one's really completely embraced it before, so they may not be in a position where they feel comfortable doing that because you don't really know what's going to happen. You don't know what kind of stories you'll get.
So again, I think with, you know, Jersey Shore cast members whose relationship is challenged by what they're watching on TV, how amazing would that be to see them watching themselves on TV and then fighting about what happened? Because that fight doesn't make any sense if you remove the context of its source, which is actually the television show that they are currently being filmed for.
Just go downstairs, huh?
Get away from me, you psycho.
Doesn't really make sense why they're fighting. One of the reasons why they're fighting was because she was seeing that Ronnie hooked up with a girl from the season previously. But they could have gone with, like, the real story, like, pull back the curtain a bit more and say, yes, this is a TV show. Yes, these people are famous.
We both agreed that going into Jersey, we'd start over.
You didn't tell him. No, it wasn't like that, like what I saw. No. It was horrible because Ronnie wasn't doing anything wrong in Jersey, but yeah, we were reliving Miami. So,
and in turn, we see elements of things like audience participation, whether it be something like voting on American Idol or gossip blogs, leaking into the reality world and affecting the way things happen there.
Producers who have decided to embrace it and bring it into the show benefit from it. Viewership goes up because they feel like they're really a part of this world because the world has spilled out into the real world.
We see elements of the world of reality television leaking into our own reality.
And that prevents you from being able to do the same show again. So you have to layer on artificiality and build up the bulk of that fourth wall even more
And I think that's where they erred in the Jersey Shore. They tried to make these people something that they weren't any longer.
Jersey Shore kind of came unstuck at the end.
Because everyone knows there's more to this story than what you're revealing on the show.
The fourth wall of reality is constantly destroyed by gossip magazines and journalists, and I include myself in that, who are interested in what happens behind the scenes.
You get kind of an internet social group working alongside the producers.
It just failed to function as authentically as it could have, which was one of the problems as the show developed.
Let's take a look. As you can see here, the ice is coming from camera side where Dina is looking. Notice when they pan to who threw the ice. We see an extended arm in retraction mode as if it was a post-throw. This arm belongs to a woman behind the camera with an earpiece connected to a walkie-talkie in hand. And why does it look like she's giving Snooki direction? Hey Snooki, break the bottles! Take a look at the bottles too. Yeah, it looks like thousands of dollars of liquor, but it's mixer.
Because that was mature. That was very mature.
You can encode anything you want, but if the consumer is going to decode it predicated on their historical knowledge, you don't have agency of changing that.
In effect, MTV was unable to lie to an intermediately connected audience.
It does suggest that there's something about that transition from one season to the other that makes it difficult to allow them to maintain whatever, you know, they were before.
Something we don't see that happening is a show like The Real World.
This is the true story.
Oh, yeah.
True story.
Of seven strangers.
Pick to live in paradise.
To live in France.
Pick to live in a house.
And have to lodge.
You get a new set of people and a new set of environments, so they don't have to react to their fame. They're just reacting.
A girl that I've never heard of before. Like,
get over yourself.
It's fucking real.
The Real World.
San Francisco.
Cancun.
Paris.
Coming up.
They were treating them like they weren't real celebrities.
But we found out it's the Survivor girl.
Yeah.
Jerry something.
Now it's a girl that I've never heard of before.
I don't care if you're a celebrity. If you treat me with disrespect, that will activate retaliation.
You know, in the beginning, reality TV was about taking normal people and putting them in unnormal situations.
In its early seasons, it was very much a documentary, but one that obviously was controlled by the casting and everything else.
We also consider shows such as
As years passed and you kind of needed to push the envelope so that you could broaden the spectrum of viewership, you start reaching into more of produced reality.
We're going into the production process with a preconceived notion of what we want or need to get out of the film.
Speaks directly to current day reality television, which most people would now call almost celeb reality.
Celeb reality. Watch the stars act just like me and you.
Whether it is looking into the personal lives of a rock star or of a celebrity who is only a celebrity for being on a reality show like a Kardashian, that's more voyeuristic.
Of course, every producer is going to jump on that and be like, well, let's make as many, you know, reality TV shows that we can.
So the industry goes back to their tried and true formula to break through the clutter with some notoriety.
Hollywood's dying, the music industry is dying, and television is hanging on simply because they cut all their budgets. You're not going to make money from your talent anymore.
You run out of those people that don't cost so much that you can't afford them to be in a reality-based television.
What happened then was that there were some of these normal people that stood out.
I was a roaring bitch.
It seems so quaint now that we think of Jerry Manthe on Surreal Life as kind of an aberration.
Well, it was really the first time that a reality star had done a second reality show.
None of us know who she is, and she's not part of our society as we know it. I don't understand why she would be part of this group.
And when you bring someone in whose celebrity came entirely from being on a similar show, it kind of made you question the entire premise.
And I think by bringing them on to surreal life, it firmly legitimizes that for everyone. Because of course we look to reality TV to tell us what is real. And surreal life has now told us that reality stars are really stars, and we believe it.
And something like TMZ really formulates that and allows reality TV to occupy star spaces in productive ways.
I mean, celebrity is about exposure.
If that's how you define being a celebrity, then hands down, most of the reality show cast people on all these shows are bigger celebrities than celebrities. Because at that point, they're brands. They're not even characters anymore. And it's like bringing Coca-Cola and Pepsi to the table and letting you hash it out.
I think, you know, again, there's like that built-in sort of audience, kind of like bringing people back on Survivor.
It's very expensive, both monetarily and time, to build a brand, or in this case, a celebrity.
I love you, spirit. That's what I've been waiting for.
It's not about me anymore. It's about them.
Wow. What a horrible nightmare.
Network television is using more celebrities to bring in viewers, whereas cable tends to feel a little bit more comfortable making celebrities out of real people.
We will make our own stars on the cheap, and then we will keep using them until they are no longer a good value for us to use.
You have like 15 minutes of fame, that's their motto, their logo, you know, 15 minutes and then you're done.
And during the time of the onset of YouTube and Facebook and reality TV, 15 minutes of fame became not only attainable, but like, who cares about 15 minutes? I can get 45 minutes in an hour-long special.
They can be reality TV stars forever. That's now a viable kind of fame.
With the cast of Jersey Shore.
I think that's a product of us learning reality television as a social norm. Both the producers learning it, the fans learning it, and the participants learning it.
We have the audience, the participants in social media, and the world of reality television being the same people.
For years, Survivor's had some of the most dedicated fans in television history.
Because now we have a full generation of kids and adults who were pretty much raised on reality television.
Survivor fans will get a chance to prove they have what it takes when they square off against 10 of their favorite players from the past.
It, on one hand, further cements that there is a difference between reality star and reality fan, but at the same time allows them to occupy exactly the same entertainment space.
Eric was a fan on the first Fans vs. Favorites, and his inexperience
like these people become the characters they've seen on past seasons, not understanding that those characters were crafted by the producers, like not presented to the producers.
You want to know what you're playing for?
Your eye.
Snooki.
But those things sort of come unstuck after into the post-real world reality TV space, where instead we have people coming in with their own archetypal brands.
Because I thought maybe I could coax you into showing the situation here.
Sick.
The view. What do you think?
Oh, well, you know what? I really don't want to really treat cheap in the product these days.
You're a brand, huh? The situation
you know
is
what?
A brand.
The brand actually is the situation.
Snooki comes in not as Nicole, it's her like cute little self, but as a predetermined self.
Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me. I'm
now,
excited.
Now, do you want me to call you Snooki? Do you want me to call you Nicole?
Snooki's cool.
And you're comfortable, you don't mind being Snooki?
Oh, not at all.
Because it's sort of representational of your persona, isn't it?
Yeah.
Something that everybody, particularly young people, are constantly encouraged to do with LinkedIn, Facebook, Twitter, with Tumblr, to create a brand and run with that is a really well-acknowledged part of our sort of marketing strategy at a personal level now.
You can
and
Twitter
you have all this other
yourself.
Stuff coming out. You
can
have like
Facebook yourself
slippers.
Yourself. You're
coming
selling
out in November
yourself
and also
as yourself.
Book. Okay, and what's
it's
the
a
book?
Major change
it's called Confessions of a Guida.
In
and it's
how
being
consumers
just
consume celebrity.
An idea of a real commodification of the celebrity process and of the self.
What the internet did was both make it possible for any individual to be famous, which kind of gives the rise of like Twitter and Facebook and sort of pay attention to me look at me, I'm filming myself and I'm on YouTube kind of thing.
Of that journey, and it's a reminder to focus on the fact that people are already being watched.
Instead of giving you celebrities and then uncontrolled access, we're giving you uncontrolled access, and that's going to take celebrities.
Institute of Higher Learning, Georgetown University, the official school of Curious George.
Reality TV celebrities, they have these talking head shots.
And then Snickers joins us in the hot tub, and that's when the party started.
Yo, can you get that shit wet?
They commentate their own lives.
Now our social media constructs our own live narratives the way reality TV works. We live in a reality TV environment, or reality TV reality in a lot of ways.
If she still has the parental controls on her TV in her bedroom, she's too young for you, bro.
The cast is really short, very, very good at capitalizing.
She's too young
for
you.
They started, the intention started capturing on Twitter.
You have the personalities now playing themselves, cognizant of the feedback received through the social media and the Inside Editions and the tabloids.
Survivor is a big story. What's the story that's going to be told this season? Who are the good guys and who are the bad guys? Who are the underdogs? Who is the audience going to be rooting for, consciously or not? What does the audience want to have happen?
What it ends up being is more than a divisive filming. We have our three walls and our fourth with the audience, but more like a bubble, one that kind of keeps reality TV effectively separate, but it's not separate. It's sort of completely permeating our environment.
The audience is going to watch you, and they're going to say, she's being loyal.
So there's probably no better conversation in the history of the show to exemplify what you're talking about. And of course they're talking about breaking the fourth wall and what is the story you want the editors of the show to make out of your experience. And he's using that conversation to turn it back around to advance himself in this game that they're playing of to work with him, because that is going to be a more palatable story for the people watching at home, and that's why she should work with him.
It's hard to know where the boundaries are or what's informing what. It becomes a bit of a chicken or the egg equation. Are we so metacognitive because of our understanding of social networking and social networking forms where reality TV constructs itself, or has reality TV informed the construction of social networking? It's hard to see those lines because these things all kind of explode at the same time.
I'm always going to have an appreciation of the three-wall mindset in a different way than you will. I will always be shocked when Groucho turns to the audience and says,
I've got to stay here. But there's no reason why you folks shouldn't go out into the lobby till this thing blows over.
To you, it's not going to be as effective. It's not going to be as funny because it's not as jarring to the convention that I'm accustomed to, that you're accustomed to.
That's awesome. Thank you. That's what I needed.
How you're going to get that with all the other flaws is beyond me, but that's why you're an editor.
Thank you very much.